Hello, hello, guys. Thank you so much for coming in tonight. I hope you're doing well. Happy Tuesday. This is day two of our Bunny Live Stitch Along. We are stitching this little bunny and making the whole wall art kit for it. Thanks for coming in. I see you starting to pop in. Thanks, replay viewers, too, if you're watching as well. And YouTube viewers, this will go up on YouTube at Penguin and Fish Movies when we're done here. Hey, Belinda, I see you guys starting to pop in. Hi, Laura, Lauren. Thanks again, guys. If you're new here, my name is Alyssa Thomas from Penguin and Fish, where we make lovely and quirky hand embroidery patterns and kits. And we are doing the Bunny Live Stitch Along this week. So yesterday we transferred our design and we started stitching. We got the little bunny ears started up there. So that's what we're gonna continue today. I think we'll get pretty far on the outline today. So thanks again, guys, for coming in. I'm gonna wait a hair longer, just so a few more people can come in before we get started. The other thing we're going to do today is wrap the inner hoop. We talked about that a little bit yesterday, how you can wrap the inner hoop so it's a little bit more forgiving on your fabric. It won't get creased by the, the edge of the hoop. So we're going to give that a try today. I'll show you kind of how to do that if you're curious or if you wanted to give it a try yourself. I would definitely use this technique if I were stitching something for a long period of time or, fancier fabric. Linen creases quite a bit. So if you're stitching on linen, you might want to do this. All right, I think we'll get going. Thanks again, guys, for popping in. I'm going to flip you around and we will start by wrapping our hoop today. Bloop. Okey-doke, here we are today. Hello, hello, everyone. Thanks for popping in here. So we can still kind of see our loop crease. So what wrapping the hoop will do, it will help make a kind of a curved edge that will help for our fabric to not crease. So, I mean, I'm not too concerned with projects that move pretty quickly like this bunny, and we're going to be framing it in the hoop anyway, so we won't see any of that. But it is not a bad idea to do. So if you want to take the extra step to wrap your hoop, that is great. Typically, you would wrap your hoop with a bias tape. You can buy a bias tape from a fabric store, or you can make your own. What a bias tape is basically a thin, like a 1 inch or so. You can get it like a 1/4 inch to a 1 inch, a bunch of different sizes. This is not a bias strip, but it's a thin strip like this, and it is cut at an angle on the fabric. So if this is the fabric, the strips would be at an angle like this. And what that means is that it'll be stretchier if you cut it at an angle, not perfectly in line with the threads of the fabric. It will, which is called the bias, if you cut it on the diagonal, it will be a stretchier fabric, which in theory will go around a circle better if it has a little stretch. I am not doing that. I am using just some recycled, I think this is linen, some linen that I happen to have hanging out already. I am all for using what you got. So if you have some muslin laying around or, even some old shirts or something, you can just cut it. This is a little 1-inch strip. That's plenty big. You can go smaller if you want. But I have a couple of them if I run out. Like I said, I just happen to have this. If you have some ribbon, that would work perfectly fine too. So what I'm going to do is I have the inner hoop right here. And I rolled this up just so I can run it through easier. But I am going to just start wrapping it around this, and I'm gonna kind of hold it at an angle just to get kind of like that angle started. I'm gonna go over about halfway the I let go. Make sure you hold it down and wrap it around. After you go once or twice, it should hold itself there like that. So I'm gonna just keep going around, keeping that kind of 45 degree angle and covering up a portion of the piece that came before. Because this is linen, I will have a bunch of little frayed edges, but that's okay. Have you ever used, and then the final piece for a bit of added poof? I haven't, but that's not a bad idea, Lauren. And Lauren, actually, you were asking about what glue, right? You could actually wrap your inner hoop, and instead of gluing down, we'll kind of go over this when we're done, but you could actually stitch it to this inner wrapped hoop instead of gluing. But I have done this, or something similar to this. Oh, you know what? It's in reach, too. Let me see. Let me grab it. There we go. You can actually do the outer hoop, and it's a decorative piece when you're done. So I did this exact same thing, but with the outer hoop instead of the inner hoop. And, you know, it's just some cute fabric, and it can just help decorate your hoop when you're done. So there are other uses to this kind of concept here. I'm gonna just keep going all the way around here, and when I run out of this fabric, I'm gonna just start it up with another piece. So you can already tell, like, it's giving me definitely a curvier edge here. This will actually hold my fabric a little bit better too. So if you're willing to do this extra step, it's definitely kind of not a horrible idea. It is going to be gentler on your embroidery fabric. I don't know. It feels awfully nice and traditional, and sometimes it feels good to connect with those things. So right now you can kind of tell that it's bunching up a little bit as I do this, like this. If this was a bias strip, I wouldn't have that problem. A bias strip would stretch easily for me, but again, I'm using what I got here, and that is perfectly fine. So we're a little over halfway. See, it's looking cute, this little linen. You know, this would be actually really cute on the outside, too. I could reuse it, and it'd be really pretty. Instead of just the wood hoop, you could do, like the fabric hoop like this. You came across your first length of thread and not sure how to do the end. Oh, so we will get to that tonight for sure. We are actually getting close to finishing this thread. Only a few more stitches on there, so I will definitely show you how to end your thread and start a new one. We will for sure be getting to that. All right, so I'm reaching the end of this guy here. So I'm gonna just, I have a few more of these. I'm gonna just start it up right where it ended up. And I'm going to hold that there. I'm not going to let go. And I'm going to just pretend I'm starting a new thing. So just around a couple times, and that couple times holds it in place again. You can stitch this on so it's more permanent, but, you know, like I could have stitched that together or started with a longer piece, but I'm good like this. I think I'll probably end up taking this off when I'm done. But all right, we are getting close to the end here. And to finish it, we are actually going to stitch it down. And now that I think of it, maybe I should have threaded my needle beforehand, but we'll see. We'll try and get it right here. You can actually do this to the inner and outer hoop to like super protect your fabric, your stitching fabric, but then you have to, you know, you can't have it be so bulky that you can't open and close. You know, it has to still, you have to be able to open this and still have it fit in, you know? So you can't get it too bulky on both sides, both hoops. All right, we are getting there. All right, so I'm gonna go to like cover up that part where I started. So right there, I got a little bit left there. I think I'll go around one more time. Yeah, right like that. And I am going to just trim it right there. So it's crossed over the underside. I'm gonna trim it right there. Last night the bunny tramps are freezing nails on an ironing board. Oh yes, so, well, the next time I iron be prone to the bunny. So Lynn, next time put a piece of paper towel or paper down, and that then it won't transfer through. I don't think it'll transfer from your ironing board to something else, if that's what you're asking. You might want to just put paper down over it and test it. All right, so I've got that there, and you know what? I did not thread my needle beforehand, so I'm going to just see if I can find a little clamp. I wonder if this works. So I have a little wonder clip here. There we go. If you have a binder clip or something, you can put that there. But I just need two hands, because I'm going to thread some sewing thread now. This just happens to be a very good color for the linen. I'm going to cut a nice edge off of there. Yeah, sorry about that, Lynn. We talked about that a little bit last night, and a few people tattooed their ironing boards. All right. So I'm going to just tie a little knot in the end here. Actually, this linen is pretty wide weave, so I don't know if this knot will hold, but we'll give it a go. So, all right. Little sewing thread. I'm going to take off this wonder clip. Actually, I might just put it over there, and I am going to just do a few loops. We'll go on the edge here. How about that? I'm going to do pretty big loops. We are going to just stitch this guy on. So I'm stitching through some of the fabric that was there from the beginning. I'm just making really big stitches. You could be more delicate, you could make little stitches, but we're going big. Alright, taking that clip off. You can use a binder clip or anything, or you don't actually need a clip. I just needed it because I didn't thread my needle first. Didn't want it all to unravel on me. Okay, and one more stitch there, and I think that will do it. Ooh, hello from Alaska. All right, so then I'm just going to grab some thread here, or some fabric here, and just tie a knot. Do another little knot. And there we go. I'm going to just actually tuck in the end, too, so I'm just going to bring the needle through the back of the fabric. Oop, I don't want to lose my needle in there, though. There we go. Okay, and we'll trim that. You actually might be able to use just your embroidery needle for this too. Okay, so there is our wrapped inner hoop. Again, you don't need to do this, but it does protect your fabric a little bit more. And you know what? It's kind of fun. All right, so let's get our bunny from yesterday back in the hoop now. So I'm just kind of centering it again. Alright, let's get this fabric out of my way. Extra little fabric to wrap. And now I'm going to have to open this quite a bit wider to accommodate for the extra thickness in that bottom hoop, the inner hoop. Ooh, you know what? I got to go even wider. I'm going to just barely make it here. There we go. Just barely. You know what? I think I could center it a little bit more. I'm going to scooch my fabric over. Way not over here, but it'll be good. Okay, there we go. And now we can pull it. It's definitely more snug already, so I don't have to tighten this at all right now while I stretch it a little. So you do, you can kind of see the little curve that we got going on here, so that will protect our thread a little bit. Oh, when you're putting the hoop on, make sure that if you are still stitching that your needle's in the center area. You don't want to accidentally have it like through the back, you know, like stuck in between here. So we're good there. I'm going to just tighten this guy a little. Feels like maybe a little loose over here, so I'm going to just pull a little bit more. I'm trying not to distort the bunny though either. That feels good. Let's tighten it up a little bit more. Here's what it looks like from the back with our little wrapped hoop. And all right, we are ready to start stitching now. So, okay. I left off right here. We finished the bunny head and I'm about to start. I did like one little stitch of, or we finished the bunny ear and I'm starting the bunny head. We talked about yesterday on kind of starting with the piece that's most farthest back. So that's, in this case, would be like the ear, and then the head's in front of that, and then this ear is in front of the head. So it kind of crosses over in front, and the head crosses over the ear. And one of the reasons I like stitching in that order is because of what's going to happen at this next stitch. So we'll do that stitch, and I'm going to come up here. Got a little fuzzle. Oh, I'm going to end up with a pile of these little linen threads. All right, so now here, this stitch is gonna cross over this, right? So that's good. That visually puts this line of the head in front of that, let me just get up here again so I can point. It visually puts this stitch in front of this stitch, which is what we want because we want this to feel further back. If we had stitched the head first and then stitched the ear, we might have had this cross over this stitch, right? And then the ear would look like it's in front of the head. And we don't want that because the ear's further back. So that's why I kind of like to have the further things back stitched first, because then we can do these things like cross over the stitches, the ends of the further back stitch. And that's what we're going to do right here as well. There we go. So now we kind of have the appearance that the head line is in front of the ear line. So I am going to just keep going around. I rotate the hoop. I don't always stitch straight. I kind of rotate it for whatever feels comfortable for my hand. So, hey Gwen, hey Sharon. So what works well for me is being able to hold the hoop and still have my left hand involved in the back. If I get too far away, like I can't reach anymore, then I'll either rotate my hoop so it feels better in my hand, so my left hand is closer, or I will move the fabric in the hoop. So I think we'll be able to get pretty far on this guy today. And we are approaching the end of our thread, so I have a little bit more. I'm going to stop when I have about 3.5-4 inches on here. So I think we can get a few more stitches out of here. Yeah, we're doing now. All right, I think this might be my last. Well, not, I think I can get like maybe two more in. We'll get this one and one more. The next stitch will be our last stitch. All right, so I have about this much left. I'm going to go finish my stitch so that my thread is on the back, and then we will flip that around. So now this is how I end my threads. Instead of tying knots, which I think can be really, make things get really messy, I weave in my ends. So I'm going to just weave in the back of the stitches. I'm going to try and grab as many little stitches as I can, many little threads, because I want it to be all mixed up in there. And I do it 3 times. 2 times I don't feel like is enough. Sometimes it just can slide out still, but the 3 times seems to do the charm to just kind of lock it in place. So that's 2, and one more time. Again, I'm trying to get all the little threads I can. All right, and then you can pull it off the needle, and then you can snip that little end away. You can snip it right close to the edge, and there we go. There's no knots flying around everywhere. There's no loose threads anywhere. So really there's nothing for our thread to catch on. on accident in the back, and it's just super duper clean. So, and again, here's what, you know, a clean back looks like through the whole thing. So this has every end woven in. You know, here's an example, you know, woven in. It almost looks like it's just part of the line. So that's what we did here. And now we can actually attend to the away knot. So remember that little knot that we did at the beginning over here? Now we just need to cut it away from the front. So pull on it a little bit so the knot comes up and just snip it. Make sure you don't snip your fabric. And that will give us a little thread on the back. So now we just need to do the same thing. Needle, here you go. We just need to weave that in the end as well. So that's how I get the, oh, that's nice, Anne. So that's how we get a back that has no knots. All right, so this thread might have been a little short, but I think we'll still get our 3 stitches out of there. There we go. Our three back and forths. There we go. All right, and I can snip that. So that is why we made that knot at the beginning, is for this purpose now. So there we go. Now both of our ends are woven in perfectly. There's no knots, no nothing. So that's that. We can grab our next thread. And so here's mine. This is the other 3 threads that came from splitting the 6-strand embroidery floss into 2 strands of 3 threads each. So this one's all ready to go. So I'm not going to tie a knot in this, and I'm not going to do the away knot either. Once we have stitches here, I can just weave into the back of them. So let's just thread this. Get it so we have just, you know, a little working area down here. And we're going to start stitching where we left off, and we're just going to continue around. Remember, we kind of had this mapped out. I'm going to do the head to here, go up the ear and down, and then jump and then go up this little bit here. So, okay, to start out, we need to weave in the ends. So we want to end up here, and we need to do 3, you know, 3 weaving in. So we have to actually start here to go 1, 2, 3 to end up back here. So I'm going to start at this other end. So I don't want to go 1, 2, 3 and then be all the way back here because I want to start stitching up there. All right, I'm going to just leave a little end there just so it doesn't get pulled through. You can hold it down with your thumb if you want. I'm going to grab as many threads as I can again. This is the second pass. And the third pass, I'm going to grab a bunch more. So that'll get a little bulky. But again, it's still going to be nicer than a knot, I think. So, all right, we wove that in, and now we can snip that little extra end off. There we go. And we are good to go again. So no knots yet, and our thread is ready. So let's keep going with the backstitch around the head here. Tempted to do his whole face before moving on to the body, but I think I'll stick with the backstitch body. You like the away knot? I've always hated the little knots in the back. Yeah, so first of all, it's actually kind of more secure to weave it in like this. Like if you were washing this a bunch of times or something, if it was for a like a towel or something, the weaving in the ends is actually a little bit more secure than a knot. Unless it's like wool or something, because wool will felt up into a knot, but something like cotton could come out. Yeah, and the other thing is, you know, when I'm pulling the needle through here, there is, like, if I have a knot down here, this guy could catch on that knot, right? And then I have, like, this big loop on the back that I don't even know that's there because it caught on a knot that was far away, right? And that sucks when you turn around your back and you found that you have this giant loop that just got stuck on a knot. So this kind of eliminates that. There's nothing to get stuck to. Whoa, except my finger. All right, so here's something. So my next stitch would naturally come right at this point, but I don't like stitching when there's something that looks like it should be in front of something else. So like this looks behind the head, right? The head is in front of the body. If both of them come to a point there, then I don't get this nice little thing here where the stitch goes in front. So I'm gonna fake this and just make it a little shorter so it doesn't end up in right the same spot. And you know, technically I could have started here because this is further back than this, and then this is further back than the head, but you know, I only do that to a degree. So I'm thinking of the head as one unit, and then I'll think as the body as another unit. And there are some little tricks to still make it look like this stitch is on top, and we will get to that when I start the body. So let's keep zooming around here. Yeah, like one shorter stitch is not gonna be a big deal. Oops, dropped my needle. Rotate a little. Into the ear just about. But yeah, if you are switching to the stabbing method where, you know, you go straight down, pull all the way through, and you come up straight up, versus the sewing method where you go in and out all in the one motion, this, if you're changing to this style, it does take a little longer. However, I bet the stitches are a whole lot more accurate because you can really see straight down into the hole where the last stitch came out. All right, here's another bit where I'm going to cross over that line. And we'll end it right there. Now let's start up that bunny ear. Rotate again, just to where it feels comfy. All right, my thread is getting towards, you know, the thread coming off of the needle is getting close to the fabric, so I'm just gonna pull on that, make my thread a little bit longer again. Need more flops soon. Oop, that guy was a little off, but not too far. So again, you want to drag your needle on the back to kind of see where you'll come up next. I find that helpful at least. You'll get used to getting really close to it, but like even there, I started out here and I just zip it over here. I'll do one short little stitch on top, kind of like how I did there, to give it a little circular, roundish top versus a point. There. Even though it's a little stitch, I am erring on the side of a cute little curved top versus my stitches being all the exact same length. Pretty low on my thread here. I'm gonna have to weave it in, which is a bummer. I didn't quite get this ear finished. A little bit more. All right, I think that's it. I think we gotta call it. So let's go to the back. I'm going to try to get one more, just so I have a little bit bigger runway to stitch in the back. Okay. Now let's view to the back. We'll weave it in here. So again, weaving it in three times. Two, three. Okay. And I'll snip that close again. There we go. Back's looking as nice as the front. So, okay. So I thought of a little thing here. So remember how my mapping it out, I was going to come down here and go back up here? I think I'm going to change that up now because we're going to have enough thread to start the body right away. So this is an awfully big jump. If I end here and jump way down there, that's a large jump. So what I think I might do instead is start up here. Actually, I think I might start, well, I don't know. Zoop, zoop. Yeah, I'm going to start here, go up here, and then weave in the end a little bit, come back down here, and then I can make this jump. So from here to here is a shorter jump from here to here. So that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to go up here, weave in a couple of these back stitches, and back down. I know, it's very tempting to keep going because you do have a little thread left, but man, it's so much nicer to be able to weave in the end and have the knots. So yeah, you're wasting an inch or two of thread, but I think that's nicer in the end. So all right, let's go to our little loops of thread again. I'm going to snip my next, I don't know, 2 feet or so. I'm using 3 strands of floss from the 6-strand embroidery floss, Carol. All right, so again, how I prefer, I used to pull them apart, but now my preferred method for splitting thread is isolating the one strand and pulling it out and letting all the rest gather behind. And then it all releases. So it looks, and then here's that piece. It looks like a crazy big knot, but it actually isn't. It just ends up being going right back to where it started. So let's use another piece. I need 3. Zoop. It looks crazy, but it ends up fine. It's a lot less likely to turn into a giant knot than if you're splitting it and just pulling it apart like that, 3 on either side. That is actually more prone to twisting around each other, and then you got a whole pile of knots. So this method works fine. So this is 3, we'll use that later. We'll start with getting these 3 together again. So then I just match up the ends here. And then just slide my finger around down the whole bit. Match them all up again. Okay, so let's continue. I'm gonna thread this end again. And again, I'm using that pinch method. I'll show you that again. Let's try and get in focus here. All right, so I'm not licking the thread or anything. I am just pinching it. You might want to give it a nice clip so all the ends are nice, but I'm just pinching it, and then I'm slowly revealing the thread, and the moment I can see it there, I put the eye of the needle over that, and then I keep releasing, and you can push it down, and then you can just grab it. I think that's a nice, quick way of doing it. All right, so what was my idea again here? Starting here, going up here, coming back down, and then jumping down here. So I'm going to weave in the backs of these stitches to start here, if that makes sense. So we'll, again, I need to, if I want to end up here, I have to go 1, 2, 3. So we're going to start weaving up here. So again, instead of doing an away knot at the beginning after the first time, I'm just using stitches that are already available to me. And grabbing as many threads as I can. One more time. All right. There we go. Snip that little end off. We don't want to get knots happening out of all the little stringies on the ends, so we're trimming them right away. And all right, let's start on here. So sometimes in a back stitch, I'll start on the end and my first stitch will actually be going forward. And then I'll start doing the back stitch after that. Little starter stitch. When you weave in, it is in different spots and through those. When you weave in, it is in different spots and through the three strands or underneath. Underneath it all. I'm not quite understanding, but what I think you're trying to ask, let me know if I'm wrong, but where, like, what do I weave it through? I'm weaving it through the back stitches, so I'm going underneath the stitches and trying to get underneath and back and forth through all of them. So I'm trying to make, like, the biggest maze that I can, so the thread has more to have to work its way through, which will make it kind of tighter on the back. So then I'm just doing that three times. Does that make sense? I'm not quite sure that's what we're talking about. All right, so let's, I think I can get three more stitches out of here. I'm dividing up, so I'm estimating, you know, I have this much space left and I'm thinking three stitches would be a better size than two, like two stitches would be two large ones, three looks just about right. So as I approach the end, I'm making those decisions. How many stitches does it look like to the end? Stitches that are consistent with the size of stitches that I'm currently using. All right, last stitch for the inner ear. And you know what? I think I'm gonna just jump right down to here. If you have a farther distance to go, you can just weave it, take a stitch in the back of the stitches like that, and then come up again. Then you don't have giant jumps of thread all over your back. I think she wants to know if you ever weave in the same spots. I try and weave in different places if I can. Sometimes if I weave in too much, like this one started and ended at the same place, so I ended the thread and then I started the new thread in the same place. So when you do that, you do get a lot of bulk. So it was nice here that I could avoid that. I ended here and got to weave it in and started here. So different spots are nice. You don't want to weave it in the exact, so you don't want to go in and out of the same holes because you don't want to be able to pull it easily. So as many little strands as you can get on the back, like a you know, as much of a maze you can on the back, the better, just because your threads will be less likely to pop out. All right, so here again, I'm gonna put that stitch over the thing that's behind it, the head's behind this ear, so I'm gonna make that stitch just normally, like I normally would, but because I'm doing it last, it's gonna look like it's covering up the head. See, so this stitch looks like it's in front of the head, and the head stitches look like it's in front of this ear. Okay, so we just ended there. I wanna start here next. I'm gonna continue on the back. And you know, I'm just continuing there because it's the shortest distance from here to there. I could go all the way down here, but then I have like a big jump, and even if I weave it in the ends, you know, why waste all that thread when I can just start right here? So I'm gonna just kind of weave in the threads a little bit so I don't have a big jump. I'm jumping behind my stitches basically like that. Okay, let's stitch some more. So now this back is behind the head, right? But we've already stitched the head. So on this first stitch, I'm going to slide my needle underneath this stitch to put the stitch in the hole. Because what I don't want to do is I don't want to go over the top this way, right? Because then the back will cross over. I want that head to appear in front. So I'm going to make sure this stitch gets underneath there. There we go. So now it still looks like the head line is in front of that back. Let's keep going. I'm gonna rotate again. This is feeling better. I think I usually stitch away from me like this. Sometimes I can't tell. whatever feels comfortable in your hand at the time. I like this color. It's pinky and corally and orangey. It's that cool coral pink, I think. That rhymed. I did not mean to do that. I think it's one of my favorite colors, this coral pink. Or orangey pink. All right, we're coming up to the tail. So now I'm starting to estimate, I'm approaching the end, I'm asking myself, okay, is this 2 stitches? No, those 2 stitches are too big. Is it 3 stitches? Yeah, it could be 3 stitches. What about 4 stitches? I divide it here and here. I'm like, those might be getting a little bit small. I think the best average to get the stitches close to these size, the stitch size I've been doing is about 3. So as I get about this close, my brain's starting to think of dividing up the space with how many stitches. So I chose 3, so I'm gonna do it in thirds, my last 3 stitches, which are hair big, but overall I think they'll look better than the 4, which I think might have been a hair too small. So overall, I think this will work better. All right, let's do that tail. Not sure we'll get this entirely done, the outline today, but we'll get close. Yeah, and if you guys wanted to post your progress in on the Facebook group page, that'd be awesome. It's so fun to see what everyone chooses to do. And I know a lot of people are doing the kit, but it's fun to see that too. Just all the progress people are making. We will have almost the whole outline of the bunny. You can stop there if you wanted, just the outline. All right, I'm kind of shortening my stitches again a little bit just to get a nicer curve. Because otherwise it'll look boxy or diamondy. With too many straight stitches. Too many long straight stitches. We kind of went over that a little bit beforehand in that video on how to make neat, even stitches. If you haven't checked that out. If you didn't know that, if you're coming to the bunny stitch along a little later, I did 3 videos. We did 4 videos. I did 4 videos before we started the bunny stitch along before yesterday. And that had a lot of embroidery tips and stuff in there. So I talked about curves in the neat even stitch video. So you can check out more info there. Oh, Carol, you got here. Yay. Yeah, I hope people are having a better time with the iPads and stuff today. All right, last stitch on the bunny tail. So let's continue with a little bit here. Again, I'm not gonna go right on the join of the line here. You know what? Maybe I should have done this guy first. Well, we're getting low on thread. I'm gonna do this line here and then this, even though this comes underneath, but oh well. Actually, you know what? I might make that first stitch, and now I'm gonna go along this foot because it's behind his little butt here. And I think I have just enough thread to make it around, which will be good because then I can start here and then just continue. Again, this is a pretty tight curve, so I'm shortening my stitches a little bit just to get that nice curve. Still more comfortable holding it here. cross-stitching this little bunny. I call these embroideries, I think I talked about this a little bit, but I call these embroideries, most of my embroideries are about this skill level, and I call them my two movie projects. So you sit through two movies, and you'll be about done with it. All right. Last stitch of the foot, and I think I have enough for a couple more stitches. So let's continue our line here. See, so now this line that I'm stitching can cross over the foot, because the foot's farther back. That's what I want. And we'll get two more stitches out of this right here. Ooh, do I have enough thread? I think so. I think I have enough for these two stitches. I'm gonna get one more stitch. We'll start this leg. Which is kind of a funny place to end, but there we go. Crossing over that little line there. And now let's weave her in. You're speeding right along. Oh, you were ahead of me when I started. Oh, just finished the second year. Yeah, well, I have been doing this a long time. So what helps actually a lot for my speed is that left hand. And I'll show you that again. I'm just kind of weaving in. Again, now I'm weaving in. I'm kind of grabbing a bunch of stitches as much as I can. There we go. Our three little bits. But yeah, I always have that active left hand, which is my hand. You know, if you're right-handed, it would be your left hand. But if you're left-handed, then it would be your right hand. Whatever the hand is on the back, I always have my fingers here. I'm always feeling where the thread goes in and when it comes out. And that allows me to go faster because there's less knots. I can feel exactly what's going on in the back. So there's less chaos can happen because I know what's going on because I'm feeling it with my back hand. All right, let's weave this in. Okay. So again, I'm going to weave in here or the leg. We'll check it out in the back. And then I'm going to start there. And I have a hunch we might not have quite enough to get around here, which is going to be a huge bummer. It's always fun to like end up with just enough floss to finish. But, you know, that's special occasions. All right. I think since we wove in right here and that's pretty bulky, I think maybe I'll weave it, the backs in here. So I'm going to start here. To go 1, 2, 3, and then we'll be right at the spot we need to be to start this leg. So let's get this more comfy. I'm going to kind of grab, I'm going to weave back and forth, grab as many little threads and go in between the threads, split the threads as much as you can. And I'm going to hold it there, take a different path coming back because you don't want to pull it right out. So again, grabbing a bunch of threads. I think my thread might be a little funny. I think we're good. All right, and then one more time, taking a different path and ending up where we need to start there. So one thing you'll notice is I'm trying to stick to my lines. I don't want to make big jumps like this because you might be able to see that big line on the back. Like I can like see, I can see that orange through. So I'm going to try and stick to the lines. So I'm weaving it. I'm not going to weave back and forth on the back of this foot. Like I'm not going to cross right there because I would be able to see that. I'm sticking to my lines. Oh, Debbie, that will come for sure. And again, if you get that backhand working, you'll start feeling, I think, a bit more coordinated. And you know, again, I started out dragging my needle across, so you can kind of see that, to find the right spot, and I just go right till I get just the right spot. So here's what my backhand is doing. I'm feeling the end of that needle, you know, my hand, I'm holding it with kind of like my inner thumb here, and then feeling it. So I'm feeling the needle, I'm feeling the thread with my finger, I'm feeling the thread pass through the fabric. And because my finger's there, it kind of gets in the way of, sometimes it loops over my finger like this, and that's actually keeping this side of the thread away from this side of the thread. Because here's when we get a lot of those knots. So I'll just show you. Let me bring this through again. Let's try and make one of those knots, actually. So if I'm doing nothing with the back of my thread, the back of, I'm doing nothing with my hand here. I'm just pulling it through. So that one was fine, right? But let's say our thread starts to get twisted up and stuff, and we don't know it because we aren't feeling it with our left hands. So I'm gonna make this stitch. Let's say this side gets tangled up with this side. We don't know what's going on, and we start pulling it through. Oh, I don't know if I can create one, but sometimes you'll get some of those loopy knots. So I'm gonna just stitch without my left hand for a little while, and we'll see if I can create one of those knots. It feels so weird though to stitch without my left hand there. So I'm gonna attempt to stitch. So I can kind of tell if something's wrong because my thread won't feel as long anymore, right? I wonder if I can recreate, just make one of those. I'm gonna try to make one of these knots. So how that happens, kind of twists around like that. Okay, so you may be familiar with a knot that looks like this. I just kind of made one. But you might look at the back and you're like, ah, crap. Where the heck did that loopy knot come from, right? This is the most common knot that happens with embroidery. And that happens, I mean, I just forced one here, but that happens because your loop caught on some of your thread. So this is just a loop that wrapped itself around another thread, and now you got this crazy loopy knot, right? I'm sure if you've done some embroidery, you're pretty familiar with knots like that. I avoid this a lot by having my hand here, my back hand doing the, what I've been saying, just like feeling what's going on back there. That alone can help prevent this. But if you do end up with a loopy knot like that, don't panic. All you have to do typically is put your needle right in that loop and pull on it, and the loop will go right up to the tip, to the needle, up against the needle. Then you can pull it out and then just kind of go in the middle of the fabric and it'll pop right out. See, there we go. Good to go, and then you can keep pulling it through. So we probably will come along another one of those knots as we go here, and we can do that again. But if you get one of those, that is the best bet. Stick your needle in that loop, give it a little pull, and give it a go. Another thing, you can try pulling on one of the threads at its base, or one will make it looser, one will make it tighter. And so if you pull one at a time, you'll know which one it is, and then you'll be able to do the same thing. You get one of those, you don't catch it in time. So, yes, okay, so having your hand back here sometimes can help you catch it in time because you'll actually feel that knot come up to your hand. But yeah, so sometimes if I don't get there in time too, I'll do the exact same thing, Lauren. If I have like a little loop here and I catch it later, I'll just kind of tack it down with my next stitch. It's not the end of the world for sure. So let's stitch without my back hand there again. We'll see if we get another one. That thread's getting a little. If you have a long piece of thread, sometimes you can get into trouble because if you have a super duper long thread, it starts to want to twist up on itself. That's why I use a little shorter threads a lot of times. I'm only using that 2 feet or so. I'm not doing like 6 feet of floss at once. And that helps prevent it get all twisted up, and then you get more of those knots with all the twists. Right, we're done with his little hip, I guess. Let's keep going on his belly. Yeah, I don't think we're gonna make it. I think we're gonna need more thread. So here's another case where I'm kind of getting my stitch behind behind his flank or hip or whatever that is, his upper leg there, because I want that to feel in front. So I'm making sure I'm getting my stitch underneath there, sliding the needle underneath there a little. I guess we'll just keep him upside down for a little while. Feels comfortable enough. Yeah, and, you know, I am stitching pretty quickly, so feel free to take time to do it. I mean, I am at the beginning, you know, doing a few other things and stuff. So now you pretty much know the basics of, you got the backstitch, we have how to start and end our floss, so you can just keep going at your own pace, and we will get close to wrapping up his body here. But you know what? I think what we'll do today, since we're getting close to our hour, I think I'm going to just stitch till I'm done with this thread. And then we may need to do a few more stitches on him, on his little legs tomorrow, because I suspect I'm not going to have enough floss, which is a huge bummer. I like when I have just enough, but I don't think I'll have that today. Oh yeah, I got some homework to do. Yeah, so that's why I want these videos just available, you know, so you can go back and take more time to do it, too. So I want to be able to get through it and be able to show you how to make it into the hoop and stuff in the week. But yeah, I'd love to see your photos of progress and stuff on the Facebook group. I love to hear, you know, if it's helping, if your stitches are becoming evener with this stabbing method, and or if there's something you're still struggling with, let me know and we will go over it, because I do want you guys to feel comfortable with all this when you're done. So if you're having trouble, like if you're curves are too pointy, or you're not happy with how even your stitches are, let me know. Even show me a pic on the Facebook page, and we can for sure take a look at it during the week here. We got three more days of this, right? Today's Tuesday. Yep. We will get this guy done. Wow, it's going fast. Day two, and it feels like it's so close to being over, only the little 7 or 5 days. Oh, I wanted to show you too. I got started on my traced one. So let's finish up this floss here, and then I'll give you a little show and tell on the other guy. Ugh, we're just almost gonna get this guy done. I'm gonna be so bummed if we don't have enough floss. Oh my god, we might just have enough though. Let's see. I'm going to do this back leg. Let's just, you know, cause it's a little bit bigger of a jump, I'm going to just kind of weave in the end here, and now we'll start stitching here instead of having a big leap from here to here. Ooh, will I have enough stitches? So here I'm going to try and tuck it underneath that front leg again. This is a tight curve, so I am going to have to do that little itty-bitty short stitch, give it some roundness. All right, coming up this guy. Oh man, it's going to be tight. Not sure we're gonna make it, but man, it would suck if I only had one stitch left to do. But let's see, can I get four or so more stitches out of here? Just have this little chest to do. Ah, can we make it? Oh, I think that's gonna require three stitches, this little line here. Right here, I'm gonna tuck it under the head again because it's behind the head. Two more. I think we're totally gonna make it. Nice. Okay, I'm excited about this. So I'm gonna actually come up in the same hole here instead of a true backstitch where I'm coming up underneath here, because I would be coming up. I don't want to stab through this thread, right? So I'm going to come up in this hole and tuck it underneath there again. Tuck it underneath that leg that's ahead of it. So there we go! All right, we totally had the exact amount of floss we needed, which is amazing. I love when that happens. It's like a little miracle for the day. So, okay, let's weave it, our three stitches, our three, not stitches, our three weaves, I guess. Three back and forths, I guess I usually call it. Three back and forths. Very literal. Still trying to catch all the threads I can along the way back. So it's a different path than the first one. All right. And we'll snip that. And there we go. There is the back. No knots. It's nice and neat. And the front, we have the outline done. And like I said, I love doing the outline first because you really feel like you get a lot done. Like we span the whole space of the thing, really, you know? So awesome. So tomorrow I think we will be able to get this entire inside done. So we will do a few different stitches. This is basically a little seed stitch, and all you're doing is following the lines, you know, there's nothing really special to it. We're just going to keep filling in these lines with little stitches. We will do this guy. This I'm just going to do in back stitches. Ooh, we're going to play with three different colors tomorrow too. This will be that gold. This is going to be his little blue nose, and then the black for the eyes. So I do have, you know, these are very tight circles. I'll show you my kind of preferred method for the eyes. It is just small back stitches, but I have a way that I like doing it so they look really nice and round, and I'll show you that tomorrow. So that's the plan. These guys, face, and then Thursday, we'll probably finish this embroidery on Thursday, actually, and then Friday we will assemble the whole thing into the cute little kit. So before we head out today, I just wanted to show you, I made a little progress on this guy too. So remember I wanted to do, this is the one we traced from the PDF pattern, but remember I did this book cover with the little turtle. I thought it'd be fun to have his little friend. So I chose kind of a rusty red color because it kind of matched the reds and stuff in here. You know, this guy was green against green, so I thought I'd do this guy kind of rusty brown tan against, you know, these rusty brown tans. So making progress on this guy too. So we got the two bunnies going. I'm pretty excited. They're fun. Can't ever have enough bunnies, right? So, and again, if you guys are doing the blue one, here is what the blue guy would look like. So cute little blue outline on there. And then that's that. So I'm going to flip you guys around and we will call it an evening and we will start this up again tomorrow. So howdy there. Here we are. This is what it looks like kind of in person. So got the little outline done. He's pretty happy. I'm excited to keep going on it. Like how you talk through the approach. Oh, of intersecting lines. That was helpful. Okay, good. I'm glad, Teresa. I try to tell you as many tips as I can. I've done embroidering for a long time. And yeah, you learn, you pick up little things like that here and there. But definitely, that's why I like starting from behind and then doing the things in the front, because you do get that effect. It's very subtle, but it does add to the effect of something being in front of something else. So I hope that helps a little bit. So, all right, we get to play with new colors tomorrow. I'm super excited. So good luck on the rest of your outline. Again, if you're wanting to share, take a pic and throw it in the Penguin Fish Bunny Live Stitch Along Facebook group. That's where you're watching this right now, probably, unless you're watching on your timeline. But, you know, click the more and it'll go to the group page. And we'll pick this up tomorrow. So thanks again, guys. And I will be doing my 9:30 scope, my live Facebook stream tonight as well. We'll be continuing on the Splendid Sampler block, my last Splendid Sampler block. So, all right, guys, I will catch you tomorrow. I'll make sure to send you another email reminder as well so you don't forget. So, see you later. Good night.